It's Monday night, and you know what that means. Downstairs Entertainment presents Rex Rivetter, Private Eye. This season builds on the characters and plot lines from previous episodes, so if you haven't caught up, we recommend you go back and listen to the episodes you've missed. We'll be here when you get back. Welcome back. And now, ladies and gentlemen, Rex Rivetter, Private Eye, in the shocking conclusion of Deadlier Than the Mail.
Are you gonna get Hazel's windows fixed?
My car? What's the matter, Angel? You afraid of a little Los Angeles smog?
It's not that. The wind whipping through when you drive is turning my hairdo into a hair... Wow, what the heck happened to you?
We should be receiving a little extra cabbage from the Jane Doe case. Burke said he would forward the reward money. I'll get it taken care of then.
Great! The neighbors are beginning to stare when you pick me up.
They probably just want to know when Grace Kelly moved into the building.
Grace Kelly? Me? Oh, boss, I've been called a lot of things. Grace isn't one of them.
Susan Hayward, then.
I want to live. Deadline at Dawn.
What?
Susan Hayward movies.
Oh, right.
Beau Jest. Reap the wild wind.
Can you call around and get me a couple of estimates on the work I'll need done on Hazel?
I'll climb the highest mountain.
Once the bank releases the reward, I'd like to get it taken care of as quickly as possible.
Oh, I can get it for you wholesale.
Really?
They won't believe me.
You're still doing movie titles, aren't you?
With a song in my heart.
Are you quite finished?
The Hairy Ape. The lost moment.
Through the frosted pane of my office door, I spied a silver silhouette, a female figure. I opened it to reveal Shirley Tempest, the Derby girl who disappeared yesterday before I had a chance to interview her.
Hello, Mr. Rivetter.
Shirley?
May I come in?
Sure. Why don't we step into my office? Angel, hold my calls.
Garden of Evil.
Have a seat. Smoke?
Sure.
I have to say, this is an unexpected visit.
Mr. Rivetter, let me start.
All right. Why don't we begin with what brings you here?
I guess I'm sorry and thank you don't really cover it, do they?
I meant, how did you find me?
That. I spoke to Julius. He told me everything that was happening.
Everything?
He and Helen are dating. She's missing. There's a ransom note. He hired you to find her, and time is running out.
He did tell you everything.
Is that a problem?
Well, it seems the kidnappers are acquainted with their situation. And apparently, the only place Julius and Helen's paths cross is at the Derby.
And you think one of the girls is involved?
Well, it seems likely.
Helen.
Yes? Why? How many girlfriends does Julius have?
What? No, not Helen Wheels. Helen Killer.
I need a program to keep up with the players.
Helen Wheels is Julius' girlfriend. Helen Killer is her roommate and kidnapper. I'd bet my life on it. You met her yesterday.
Why do you think it's Helen? Why do you think it's Killer?
Those two did not get along.
Is that unusual? Lots of women don't get along.
Not Wheels. She got along with everyone. She is such a sweet, kind, caring girl.
Oh?
I told you, she and Killer did not get along, and yet she rents a room to her.
Rents a room?
Yeah. The place they live belonged to Wheels' grandmother. When she passed away, she left it to Wheels. Killer needed a place to stay, so even though they hated each other, Wheels couldn't stand the thought of Killer having no place to go. She was like that.
How did you know her?
I was going through I had a medical thing a few months ago. She was so very supportive. She looked after me.
A medical thing?
You've met my husband, Mr. Rivetter.
Did he hurt you?
What? No, I... We...
It's all right. You're safe here.
We already have 3 children, Mr. Rivetter. I don't want any more. I found out I was...
With child?
Yes.
Oh.
Please don't tell anyone. I shouldn't have said anything.
It's all right. Just not what I expected.
I know it sounds horrible. Clark is a wonderful provider. I only... It's a lot.
I'm not here to judge, Mrs. Anderson. I just want to find Helen.
Thank you, Mr. Rivetter.
Tell me, how did you...
Mexico, Mr. Rivetter. I had it done in Mexico. It was...
Dangerous.
Yes.
I'm very sorry.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I can't stay. I just wanted to... I'm very sorry about yesterday.
It's all right, Mrs. Anderson.
Shirley. Call me Shirley.
All right. Shirley. She gets up and heads to the door. I follow her. One last question, Shirley. How do you do it? And why?
The Derby.
Yes.
Mr. Rivetter, a girl needs some excitement in her life. Something she calls hers that she doesn't have to share with her husband. A little adventure. An escape. Some gals get a thrill from the occasional dinner out. I guess it's the idea that somebody else will do the dishes for once. But there are some that just need more. It's a man's world, Mr. Rivetter. You have all the power, so you can't begin to see how the rest of the world lives because you've never been in our shoes. Take your secretary, for example.
Assistant?
How much time do you spend with the slug?
Well, I... Time? I don't know.
And how often does he thank you?
Look, lady, it's not like that.
That often, huh? It's not his fault, I guess. He's just a man. He can't help it. He was raised that way.
So it's just for kicks, then?
Kicks? No, Mr. Rivetter. I do it so I can feel the wind in my hair. I do it to push myself to be better at something today than I was yesterday. I do it because each of those girls has something to offer me, and hopefully I have something to offer them. I do it for freedom. Something I bet your girl here could use.
Hey, I have all the freedom I need, thank you very much.
Do you? Or have you just been taught to think that way?
Lady, you don't know the first thing about me.
Are you married?
No, but I...
But you wanna be.
Well...
It's okay. We do what we're told. Sure, we held down the fort when the war was going on. We drove trucks, worked in factories, repaired airplanes. But now we're back to things as usual. We cook and clean and keep a household. But what if there's more to life?
There is more to life. Friendships, a career, building something you can call your own. Getting shot at. Some folks go looking for adventure. Some have it plopped right in their lap, whether they want it or not.
Mm. I like her, Mr. Rivetter.
Oh, I'm so glad.
Honey, if you ever get tired of playing Effie to his Sam Spade, you should come down to the Derby. I think you'd fit in swell.
Thanks. I think.
I hope you find Helen, Mr. Rivetter. And I hope she's okay.
Take care, Mrs. Anderson.
Shirley.
That was different.
You kind of like her, don't you?
Oh, I think I've made enough new girlfriends this week, thank you very much. Mm,
probably for the best. Huh. All right, Angel. I'll be in my office in case we get any more visitors. I need to make a call.
Sure thing, boss.
I rang up the Red Lantern to check in with my client. I had a lead. And I needed an address.
Good morning, Mr. Rivetter.
I wasn't sure I would find you in the bar this early.
Everybody's got to be somewhere.
Have you heard anything new?
No. I'm going to have to pay, aren't I?
Maybe. I have a lead.
Is it solid?
I'd start gathering the dough together, just in case.
That's solid, huh?
Hopefully I'll know more in a couple of hours.
What can I do?
You have Helen's address?
Sure. Why?
I want to take a peep, and maybe talk to her roommate.
1436 Spalding, right off Pico.
Okay, got it. stay by the blower.
Sure thing. Hey, Rivetter, how's the eye?
I'll call you when I'm through. A quick goodbye to Jenny, and I was off to the Helens place. Helens's? Is it Helens? Helens's? Driving in Los Angeles traffic gives a man an opportunity to ponder the really important things in life. A kidnapped girl, a Roscoe happy rat-faced killer with the uncanny ability to find me no matter where I go, a car with so many holes in it, when the wind whips through it, it sounds like I'm playing a piccolo, a mysterious benefactor that's been paying my rent, and, of course, who the hell is Tiny? And why does he want me dead? Helen's is? I don't know. I arrive at a small Mediterranean single-story bungalow built in the 20s. Palm trees lined one side of the street, their yellow fruit littering the road and sidewalk. No car in the driveway. No answer at the door. And I didn't have a key to the place. I was pretty sure I wouldn't fit in the milk slot, so I would need to slip through a window. For that, I would have to get around back of the house. Sure, breaking into the place is pretty extreme if my information is bad, but I'm running out of time to resolve this without making my client pay the ransom. Two bedrooms, one bath, a living room, and a kitchen. No frills, but less to search. I call that a win. The first bedroom I check is littered with clothing on the floor. On the unmade bed, chest of drawers left open with ladies' things spilling out of them. A makeup bag with cosmetics strewn around it. I check the closet. Some hat boxes, a suitcase lay on the floor, shoes in disarray. In short, it looks like a hurricane hit the place, and there were no survivors. The second bedroom was the complete opposite. The bed was made. I opened dresser drawers, and each item was folded and placed neatly inside. The closet was the same, save for a few empty hangers. Clothing seemed to be organized by color and season. Short sleeve dresses in the back for the coming summer, long sleeved in front. No suitcase. But it could be elsewhere. Looking around the room, I spotted a few pictures on a desk and atop the dresser. The same girl appeared in all of them, but I didn't recognize her. One featured an older couple with her between them. Parents, I assumed. She has her mother's cheekbones and her father's eyes. A handsome family. Also on the desk was an old Olympus typewriter. It was a long shot, but I've worked with less. After inspection, I noticed the H and E stick together, and I have to manually remove them before continuing, probably from continuous use, and the ribbon needs to be replaced. It was the type with only one color, black. It wasn't likely this was the machine used to type the ransom note. I moved out into the living room. A small radio, some books on a bookshelf, a plate with a half-eaten sandwich had been left on the coffee table. The kitchen was more of the same. Dirty dishes left in the sink, the trash was full. Laying at the top of the heap in the wastebasket was an empty box. Royal typewriter ribbon. Two-tone. Black and red. Somebody had been clicking on keys in this joint. Just not on the machine in the clean room. On a hunch, I returned to the first bedroom I was in. The dirty one. Inside a large hat box at the back of the closet was a typewriter with two-tone ribbon. A before I had a chance to investigate further, there came a not-so-gentle rapping at the front door.
Los Angeles Police, open up.
Well, damn.
Come on, come on, come on.
Honey, what you doing?
Eating Welsh cakes and drinking tea with the dog.
In your jammies?
Yep.
At noon?
Yep.
How productive of you.
Hey, I'm also supporting a female-owned small business while simultaneously expressing my current mood through the power of scented candles and sass.
Is that why it smells like... Wait, what does that smell?
You'll figure it out.
Childhood. It smells like childhood.
Yeah, it does. It's my new favorite candle from Evil Queen, Candles with Attitude. Evil Queen is a Los Angeles-based, female-owned small business that sells amazing, handmade soy wax candles. They're vegan, non-toxic, with 100% cotton wicks, and they smell fabulous. I pretty much always have one going up here. That's why it always smells so good.
So, what exactly is this scent?
Can't adult today.
Yeah, I can see that. You're in your jammies curled up on the dog bed with Rocco.
Read the candle label.
Can't adult today. Got it. Smells like sweet fruits, cereal milk, and morning cartoons. Yeah. Yeah, it really does.
Yep.
It also says on here, my favorite childhood memory is not paying bills.
Me too.
We actually do have to pay bills.
I know.
Did I mention it's noon? What are you doing?
Lighting a different candle.
Well, what's that one? Okay, and now you're not talking to me. And you, got it, want me to read the new candle label. Moody bitch. Smells like vanilla sugar, musky floral, and definitely ignoring you. Huh. It really does smell like that. That's impressive.
Mm-hmm.
You can get your Evil Queen candles at shopevilqueen.com. They really do smell really, really good.
And we know you may be looking to do some holiday shopping, and small businesses could really use your support and help right now. We encourage you to find some small businesses, like Evil Queen, to support this holiday season and all year long.
If you're not into candles, there are millions of other small businesses and independent bookstores out there that would love your patronage. Not sure where to start? Literally just open up your favorite search engine and search small business or independent bookstore and the name of your city, and we can pretty much guarantee that you'll find a good place to start.
And if you find a small business you love, don't keep it to yourself. Tell your friends. Or you can post about it on social media.
Or you could write a goofy mid-roll ad about it and make your husband put it in his audio drama.
Or that.
Yep.
You know, I didn't force you.
No.
You actually love that Can't Adult Today candle.
It is my favorite.
Hey, what do you mean your audio drama?
Oh, nothing. Did I say mine? Our audio
You're
drama.
You're nothing without me. I bet I have a candle for this, too.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we return to Rex Rivetter, Private Eye, in the stunning conclusion of Deadlier Than the Mayo.
Here I am, stuck inside the home of a possible kidnap victim, with the cops at the door, and me without a ready excuse. It's time to blow before I end up in the pokey again. I just climbed down from the window I entered through, when one of the boys in blue rounds the corner at the back of the house and spots me.
Hold it right there, mister.
I don't think the old I was looking for my lost cat story is going to work this time. Come to think of it, it didn't work the last time. Oh, thank goodness you're here, officer. I think I saw someone go into this house.
Collins, around back. I've got him.
Yes, right in there. I was looking to see if I could spot him, but I, what the hell?
Freeze, mister!
All right. No need to get hysterical.
Who are you?
The name is Rivetter. Rex Rivetter. License number 698753, issued by the Police Department of Los Angeles. Occupation? Private detective, sometimes known as a private eye or private dick.
Shut up!
What are you doing here?
Investigating, same as you.
Doubtful.
We're looking for a suspect in a string of B&Es in the neighborhood. We got a call from a neighbor about a guy sniffing around this place.
Matches your description?
Know anything about that?
Just what you've told me so far. But please continue.
So, what are you doing here?
I told you. Investigating.
Investigating what?
I can't say.
Can't or won't?
A little from column A, a little from column B.
Look, pal.
Rivetter.
Fine. Look, Rivetter.
Rivetter. With a V?
What?
Rivetter. One V, two R's, and two T's.
Okay.
Nope. No O's, no K's.
You...
None of those either. Look, Junior, why don't you tag your partner in? I think you're done.
All right, Mr. Rivetter. You got any identification?
It'd be funny if I dropped it while I was in the house, wouldn't it? Except I was never in the house.
We'll see about that. Identification. Slowly.
There you are.
Check it.
Right.
Want me to read it to you?
Shut up. Seems legitimate. It's got Parker's signature on it.
Swell guy. We get our shoes shined together.
All right, wise ass. If you're not going to tell us what you're doing here, we're going to take you downtown and book you on a 459. Know what that is?
A lot of paperwork for you and a misdemeanor charge for me. At best.
You seem to know a lot about crime.
Whiskey Bill and I share a manicurist, too.
All right, jackass. Let's go.
The two are good to their word. We take a trip downtown. And after some fingerprinting and a quick frisk, they seat me on a bench in a holding cell for a while. Probably to let me think about what I've done and start to sweat. I ask them for my usual table. Apparently, I forgot to call ahead and make reservations. 3.5 lifetimes later, Miller, the dumb one, comes to get me.
Sit down!
All right, Rivetter. We checked you out. Seems like you're who you say you are.
Who in their right mind would claim to be me if they weren't?
So, care to tell us what you're doing outside that house?
Sorry, boys. Can't help you.
Can't? Or won't.
We've done this bit before. You were there, and you were there.
Come on, Collins. Give me 5 minutes alone with him. I'll get him to talk.
Please, sweetheart. You haven't got what it takes. I have a tougher time putting on my shoes.
Is that so?
Look, Officer Collins, is it? Do us all a favor. Go get Lieutenant Burke. He'll vouch for me. Probably.
Burke?
Yeah. Tall guy, looks angry all the time, has a sermon for every occasion.
I know who he is.
Good. Send Junior here over to fetch him. We can get this cleared up in no time.
He's not here.
What?
Burke's not in today.
He takes days off?
No, not many anyway. He just didn't show up today.
Didn't show? Is that normal?
I wouldn't worry about him. I'd worry about you.
Well, that's awfully sweet of you, sourpuss, but I'm doing just fine. I am, however, in a bit of a rush. So if there's nothing else...
Not so fast.
Book me or boot me.
We could book you.
For what? By now you've been inside the house, right?
Yeah.
Any damage to the place?
A little messy, but nothing permanent.
And you've searched me?
Yeah.
Find anything unusual? Artwork, a television set, any women's undergarments?
No.
So what have you got? Nobody spotted me inside. You've got a neighbor that saw me go around back, and that's where I was when Tweedledim here came around the corner.
If we send in a team, are we going to find your fingerprints in the house?
What would that cost, I wonder?
What?
Sure, those crime scene guys don't work for free, do they?
Nope.
You're going to tell your superior to send them in and dust the place on the possibility that I was in there, even though there was nothing stolen and no damage was done. Cut me loose. You've got no reason to hold me.
Get out of here, Rivetter. Don't let me catch you back at that house, or anywhere for that matter.
Thanks, officers. It's been a real slice of heaven.
Collins! You can't! Collins, that was a good collar!
Where is he?
Sergeant?
Where's Rivetter? I heard he got himself pinched for a B&E. Where'd he go?
He walked.
What?
Collins here let him walk.
What?
Sergeant.
No, I...
That's what I said.
Sergeant?
Are you crazy? How could you let him walk away?
I'm with you, Sarge.
Get back in here now.
Hold on now, Sergeant.
I've been trying to tell him.
By the time I make it outside, it's almost 7 o'clock. I make a quick call to the office to tell Jenny I won't be coming by to take her home. She says she'll grab a cab and that I should call her later. By the time I catch my own taxi back to my car, it's 8 o'clock. I head to the Lantern to fill my client in on the investigation. The look on his face is two parts shock, one part disappointment, with a resignation garnish.
So guess I'll have to pay up then.
Can I ask you a question?
Shoot.
How sure are you that Helen isn't in on it?
Killer?
No, the other one.
Wheels?
They really need different names.
No way.
I think it would make it easier to tell them apart if they had different names.
No, I mean there's no way my Helen is involved in her own kidnapping.
I only ask because of what I found. One room was a disaster.
Killers. She's a slob.
While the other one was very neat.
Wheels. She arranged all of her clothes...
By color. Yes, I noticed that. There seemed to be a few items missing, but not many. And then there was the typewriter.
She wanted to be a newspaper reporter. She had that thing for years.
Some of the keys stuck.
She'd mentioned that.
It's not likely that was the machine used to write the ransom note.
But...
There was another machine in Killer's closet. It might have been the one used to write the notes, but I can't be sure.
Do you think...
Killer kidnapped your girlfriend? Maybe. There was evidence she knew Wheels was going to be gone.
Evidence?
It was Wheels' house, right?
Yeah, so?
And she was renting a room to kill her.
Again, I say yeah, so?
Your girl's room was neat and tidy.
Go on.
But the rest of the house was lived in. Would the missing Helen have stood for a mess from Killer?
No way. They argued about it several times.
There were dishes in the sink and the trash was full. Clearly... Killer didn't expect your girl to come home anytime soon.
So you think Killer is involved?
Well, it seems possible.
Well, if that's the case, there's no way the two of them are working together. They didn't get along.
So I've heard.
Well, what do we do?
You get the money together?
Yeah.
Well, at this point, the only thing left to do is pay the ransom and try to catch her when she picks it up.
I don't like it.
Well, it's not too late to bring in the cops.
No. We'll handle this ourselves.
We?
You're not gonna quit on me now, are you?
Well, the thought had crossed my mind.
Who's gonna back me up if things go sour?
What about one of your many friends? The fellow that owns the car, the one that owns this bar, the one that got you involved in the derby in the first place.
How am I supposed to know if I can trust any of them? You seem to think that Killer is involved. What if she's got more help from somebody close to me?
Fine.
Thank you, Mr. Rivetter. You're not such a bad egg.
Oh, don't go soft on me. I just want to see how it all turns out. So, that's how we found ourselves waiting in one of my client's borrowed cars in the parking lot of the train museum at 11 o'clock at night, an hour before the exchange. Moonlight from a waning crescent sliver above did little to illuminate the area. The day's heat... combined with the evening chill trapped by the hills to the south, turned to a thick fog that crept across the fairgrounds. It was the perfect setting for the climax of some Hollywood writer's fantasy where the bad guy gets shot, but nobody wins. At half past, I got out of the car and made my way behind a yellow Union Pacific engine. From my vantage point, I could see where Julius sat. I was betting on the fog and the dark covering me. I looked at my watch, but it was too dark to see the time, so I began counting.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
I figured if I got to 600, I would reassess the situation. It was crude, but there wasn't much else to do. I didn't have to wait long. By the time I got to 60, I saw a shadow moving past a caboose and along a boxcar in Julius's direction. When it got to the front of the train, they stopped and shone a light in the front windshield where my client sat. At this distance, I couldn't make out features, but the newcomer wore a long coat and hat. They were tall, but thin, and they moved with some grace. I had to assume it was Killer.
Who Who's that?
Did you bring the money?
Killer?
Did you bring it?
Yeah, I got it.
Stay right there. Don't come any closer.
Where's Wheels?
She's safe. You'll see her soon enough, as long as you brought the money.
I want to see her now.
It's not gonna work that way.
Come on, killer. Just let her go.
I said don't move. I have a friend real close by. You take one more step and he'll put a bullet in your brain.
I wasn't sure whether to believe her or not. I couldn't see anyone else, but maybe they were hidden too. I was hoping Julius wouldn't take a chance.
All right, all right. So how do you want to do this?
Drop the money, right there. Then get in your car and drive away.
Then what?
As soon as I know you're gone, I'll grab the dough and be on my way.
And Wheels?
Provided there's no funny business, I'll send her back to you in one piece.
How do I know you're telling the truth? How do I know you haven't hurt her?
I guess you'll just have to take my word for it.
Right now, your word doesn't mean much.
A flash from across the tracks. Couldn't be sure where it came from, but I had a general direction. One. I started to move around the back of the train, behind Killer, to find her friend.
I told you not to move!
Okay, okay!
One more step, one more move, and it will be your last. Do you hear me?
That comment wasn't for Julius. It was directions to her pal.
Yeah, I hear you.
Drop the money.
I don't have it.
What?
That's right, Julius. Stall her. Give me more time to find her accomplice.
You said you had it.
I brought it. It's in the car. I have to get it.
Do it, but move slowly.
Okay.
Hurry up!
Well, which is it? Move slowly or hurry up?
Just give me the money.
Okay.
I get around the back of the train, and for just an instant, there's a glint of steel. Moonlight off a gun barrel. Or maybe it's dew from fog. Whatever it is, I try to move toward it slowly, while my client tries to keep Killer talking. From 20 feet away, I can see the barrel of a rifle atop a rail car, pushing into the night. My target. Now, I just need to climb the ladder on the back of the train to get the drop on him. I pull my .38 from its holster and move as quietly as I can.
Good. Now leave it there and get back in your car.
I'm not going anywhere without help.
You'll do as I say or you'll never see your girlfriend again.
Forget it, killer. You and your pal can hang yourselves. I'm not... Damn!
Two. My head clears the roof of the rail car in time to see a puff of smoke dissipate from the barrel of an M1 carbine. It has a straight clip, not the curved banana-shaped ones that the servicemen prefer now, meaning it holds 15 rounds instead of 30. That was something, at least. The figure holding the rifle lay sprawled across the roof wearing a gray checkered long coat with fur around the collar. Fur? And low-slung heels. What the? That last part was apparently out loud because the shooter turned suddenly, and I'm face to nozzle with Betty Boomerang, another derby girl.
You!
Me! Three. She squeezes the trigger, but it fires wide. I duck down below her sightline just before I lose my head. Four. I stick my hand over the ladder and let go a barrage of my own light in a variety of directions. One of the bullets finds its mark.
Shit.
Betty falls on top of the rail car, then off the car onto the ground below.
Son of a bitch!
Rivetter, where you at? She's got the money, Rivetter. She's getting away. Rivetter.
Where is she?
I stood on top of the rail car searching for Helen Killer, but from below, Rivetter, Betty fires at me. Five.
What's
going on
over
there? Six.
Rivetter. Rivetter.
Eight.
Rivetter, she's
getting away. Nine. I back away from the edge, still looking for Helen, but she must have moved behind the train. I look for Julius and see a dark form on the ground.
Julius?
I'm all right. She had a gun, but she can't shoot worth being.
You see her?
10. Five more in Betty's clip.
No, she took the money and ran back the way she came.
Damn.
For Christ's sake!
Is that you firing?
No, it's Betty Boomerang!
Boomerang, Betty!
Is that really important right now?
I jump to the top of the next car, earning myself more lead from Betty as I make my way to the back of the train. 11. 12.
Get back to the car, Julius. Get out of here. I'll grab Helen. 13. 14.
I move as quickly as I can to the other side of the train, where I was hiding out earlier. The fog wraps its thick tendrils around me, and I'm shrouded in darkness. I hear footsteps coming up behind me. I hide behind a train car in time to see Betty limping around the corner. Drop it! She swings the barrel of her M1 toward me. 15. I step from the shadows into... less shadow. You're out.
Unless I reloaded.
Not enough time.
You willing to bet on that, Rivetter? By my count, you fired 6 shots at me. You're the one that's out.
Unless I reloaded.
A game of chicken then, huh?
I don't like to hit women. But I didn't think you'd mind being an exception.
You pansy, you hit like a child.
You're not gonna need your rifle.
Hand to hand. I could probably take you without it.
But I've still got my pistol trained on you, so let's play nice.
All right, killer. I've got Betty. Let's make a trade.
Mister, she's long gone by now.
Unfortunate for you. Tell me where she's keeping Wheels. Provided the girl's safe, we might be able to work out a deal with the cops.
You go to hell.
A shot rings out from a distance and finds its home in Betty.
That bitch.
She spits up some blood. Black patches on a gray fur-lined coat. A final breath leaves in mist from her lips. Boomerang Betty dies, there in the open, surrounded by metal beasts, their bellies empty. I blend back with the shadows of the train, searching the midnight gloom for movement. The quiet night, my only companion. As motionless as stone, I wait. Another shot. Wild. She doesn't see me. But I fire back anyway. Huh. Empty. Betty was right. I was so busy counting her shots, I forgot to count my own. I make a dash in the direction Killer fired from, but find nothing for my trouble. In time, I make it back to Julius, parked where I left him. At least he's unharmed.
Well?
Betty's dead. Shot by Killer, I assume.
And Killer?
In the wind.
And my money?
Gone with her.
Damn it, Rivetter!
There was nothing I could do. If I moved earlier, she would have clammed up and we'd never found your girl.
You could have tried.
Betty had you in her sights. One slip up and you might be singing in St. Peter's choir.
You got a lot of faith.
It wasn't that tough of a shot. With that rifle, a child could have made it.
Not in Betty, in me.
What's that mean?
St. Peter's Choir. You've got me headed in the wrong direction, Mr. Rivetter. So, now what do we do?
I think it's past time we involve the cops. Never thought I'd say this out loud, but I have a friend on the force. He might be able to help.
All right. We'll find a payphone and you can give him a call. Is he working the late shift?
Oh, damn. Actually, he's not on today. Never mind.
So, no cops?
No. You should still give them a call, if for nothing else, to let them know who to look for. Julius takes me back to my car at the Lantern. I wait with him while he phones the police, but tell him it might be better if I'm not there when they arrive. Going home is out of the question, so I find my way back to the Helens'. There's not much chance the killer will be there, but it's my only lead. I park and make my way across the yard when I see something unnerving. A light in the house. I don't bother with the bell. I make with shoe leather against the front door and I'm greeted by sonic shockwave, screams, and the sound of dishes against the kitchen tile floor.
Who are you?
Who am I? Who are you? It turns out the girl in the kitchen of Helen Wheels' house is Helen Wheels. Once the hysteria died down, mine and hers, I had her phone the lantern and talk to my client. He may not have even hung up the phone before getting behind the wheel of his borrowed car to come over. In the meantime, she tried to fill in some blanks.
I was away.
Away?
Yes, away. It's the opposite of here.
Oh, thanks for the rundown. Where were you?
Hold on, not so fast. So, you're a private detective?
Yes.
Hired by Julius?
Yes.
To find me?
Still yes.
But I'm not missing.
Hence the confusion. Did anyone know you were going away?
I told Betty, so she could tell Julius.
Why didn't you tell him yourself?
He told you about our... about us?
He did.
I thought it would look less conspicuous. If Betty told Julius, it wouldn't seem like I'd had a private conversation with him.
And did you tell her how long you'd be gone?
Yes, I suppose.
Did you tell her where you were going?
I went to Mexico.
Mexico?
To visit someone.
A doctor?
Yes. How did you know?
Just a guess.
Please don't tell Julius.
Was it someone else's?
What? No! But I couldn't. Mr. Rivetter, people would... they wouldn't understand.
No. I suppose not. But would that matter?
What?
What others think? Would that matter?
Easy for you to say. You're a man.
Yeah, I've heard this one before. How can I begin to comprehend what it's like to be someone else? Someone that isn't me. Y'all should start a club.
Oh, that's him.
So my job here is done. But he's gonna want to know something.
Helen!
The next 30 minutes is spent with the two of them holding each other and generally doing what lovers do.
You're safe now. It's all right.
At least as much as they're willing to do with someone else in the room. Eventually, though, the conversation shifts from love to money.
I'm so sorry.
It's okay. It wasn't your fault. Betty must have told Killer and they came up with the idea to get the money from me.
Is there any way you can get it back?
No. Not unless I can find her before she leaves town.
Did you tell the police?
I showed them a picture I had for publicity purposes. They said they'd watch the airport and bus stations. They're going to try and get in touch with the sheriffs in Orange County and San Diego in case she tries to drive down to Mexico.
Which airport?
Los Angeles.
What about Ontario International? The look on his face told me everything I needed to know. He gave Helen some pocket money and the keys to his car. Then he and I made for Ontario. By the time we made it there, the sun was peeking over the mountains to the east. Ah, it was too late. We knew it as soon as we arrived. The woman at the counter told us as much when Julius showed her Killer's photo.
Yes, that's her. She was a late arrival, almost missed the flight.
Where was she headed?
Shanghai.
Damn.
Oh, I am sorry.
It's all right. Tell me, how did she pay?
Cash. Small bills. Lots of them.
Flight 24 is now arriving at...
We leave the airport. On the way back to my ride, Julia stops to watch a plane taxi down the runway. Sorry we didn't catch her in time. Quite a bit of dough to lose.
Yeah, it is. But at least I have Helen back. That's something.
Yeah, I suppose it is.
Besides, it's just money. I can make more.
Make more? You mean... Julius, the ransom you paid, was that...
Mr. Rivetter, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful tolerationship.
All right,
Rex told me he wouldn't be by to take me home, but I wait for a while in the office, just in case. It's not like I have anything else to do. Around 9, I decide to call it a day. Is it still a day if the sun is down? Friday night. I should take a little mad money and grab a cocktail with my girlfriends. Except I don't have any girlfriends. Or any mad money either. At least not as much as I used to, what with all the extra expenses. So instead, I catch a taxi home. At least there's someone waiting for me there. Well, Stanley will be happy to see me, though he'll never show it. Instead, he'll howl at me for being late with his dinner. Oh, sorry. You startled me.
I didn't mean to. Oh, please forgive me. Oh,
it's all right. I just... Oh, wait. Apartment C? That's the Millers. The older couple, right? I met them a few days ago. They came over to welcome me to the building. Very sweet. Are you a friend of theirs?
My parents. Yes.
Oh. Well, that's nice. You paying them a visit?
Well, actually, I live here. Yeah, they were visiting me from Michigan.
Oh, family. Coming to visit. That's something.
Yes. They come out every year to stay for a while. I think they imagine I sit in my apartment all by myself.
I wouldn't know what that's like.
No, of course not. A young, attractive woman such as yourself. I imagine you have lots of suitors.
Lots of suitors?
Not too many, of course. Just the right amount.
No kidding.
I'm sorry. I never seem to know what to say to people. I'm much better with numbers and calculations.
Oh, well, what are you, an accountant or something?
An actuary, actually.
A what?
An actuary. I use math and statistics along with the business and finance probability to determine the premiums for insurance plans.
Well, that sounds fascinating.
Oh, it is.
Well, Mr. Miller, it was nice meeting you.
Yes. My parents' name. That's very astute.
That's me. Astute Jenny. Oh, I used to be clever, but I got a promotion.
Well, I imagine you have a big night planned. I don't want to keep you. It was a pleasure meeting you.
Oh, a big night? You have no idea. Say, where were you off to just now?
Off to?
Well, sure. You came out of your apartment like a man on a mission.
Oh, just checking my mail.
Got it. Well, good night.
Francis.
All right. Good night, Francis.
Good night.
Jenny.
Jenny.
Oh, what the hell? Hey, Francis? What are you doing tonight?
Tonight's episode of Rex Rivetter, Private Eye starred Randy Coull and Rhiannon McAfee and featured William Robinson as Julius Page, Fatima Pimienta as Shirley Tempest, Adam Sheldon as Sergeant Monroe, Lena Jones as Helen Killer, Rachel Bishop as Helen Wheels, and Raylene Wall as Boomerang Betty, with John Gully, Alex Guzman, and Jody Olsen. It was written by Greg McAfee, directed by Rhiannon McAfee, and is produced in San Diego, California by Downstairs Entertainment, with editing and sound design by Steve Murdock. The Rex Rivetter theme, Nightmare, and Jenny's theme, Softly, as in a Morning Sunrise by the Artie Shaw Orchestra, are used with permission of Music Sales Corp. If you enjoyed tonight's episode, please find us on the internet at www.dsentertain.com or on the Facebook or the Twitter. And be sure to join us in 2 weeks for Rex Rivetter Private Eye in part one of The Final Farewell. For Downstairs Entertainment, this is Greg McAfee speaking.